Hello and welcome. My name is Nate from Video Games Recon, and in this video I thought I'd throw some knowledge bombs at you in the form of 10 tips for first-time PC builders. As just before Christmas, I built my first PC and thus have accumulated some knowledge and advice that may help anyone wanting to build their own PC, be it for gaming, editing, spanking your monkey, or any other purpose. So obviously this isn't a build guide, just some thoughts I had in retrospect, and the footage in the background will mostly be game footage from my PC probably captured in Shadowplay. Anywho, some of this advice I knew before I started my build that I had gathered from my research, and some things I wish someone had told me before I started my build. Now, first off, I would just like to preference this by saying I am in no way an expert on this topic. This is just some tips from one former first-time builder to another first-time builder, in the hopes that it may help. FYI, if anyone is interested, my specs will be in the description. So, without any further ado, and in no particular order, let's do it to it. 10. Okay, so first up, as touched on earlier, research is very important on grasping the basic concepts needed, be it choosing the right components for your needs or the build itself. The good news is, just by watching this video, you've already started that process. So go ahead and watch a bunch of videos on the subject and look on well-known PC-centric sites, i.e. Linus Tech Tips, Tom's Hardware, etc. Also, it doesn't hurt to ask advice on said sites. Often someone will get back to you and help out if you word your post coherently. 9. One early and big choice is whether to go with Intel, Nvidia, AMD, or even a mix and match approach for the components for your build. For me personally, I wanted to see what it was like on the other side, as had always gone AMD. But as a very rough rule, you tend to get more bang for your buck with AMD, whereas in my limited experience with Nvidia, you tend to get a more streamlined experience over AMD's Catalyst Control Center, which I've had a few issues with before, and the driver/compatibility seems to be a little bit better for games and some video editing software with Nvidia. However, take this with a pinch of salt, as it's more of a case-by-case basis, as some games can be better with AMD and some with Nvidia, so it's a bit of a crapshoot, and purely a personal preference thing. So do your due diligence, but don't worry about it too much. 8. Next is making sure you get parts that are not only right for your needs, but making sure they are compatible, as not all parts are equal and use the same architectures, i.e. AMD chips won't work with an Intel board and vice versa, and DDR4 memory won't work with DDR3 boards, etc. So aside from using tip 10 and doing your research, I'd suggest using a website like PC Part Picker, links in the description, which will automatically tell you whether you have an incompatibility issue, on top of which you can check out other similar rigs at similar price points for ideas, and even get prices and links for parts. 7. So let's talk power units. First off, the higher the watt, the better the power supply is not per se true. Something like the make and rating is probably more important, as if you get a cheap make, it's more likely your power unit will fail at some point in the future. And if it does, God knows what components it might take with it. So skimping out on a decent power unit is not a good idea. And the rating is also important, as let's say you have a 1000 watt supply, but it only has an 80 plus bronze rating. That means, and as far as I understand it anyway, due to its efficiency, it may only be dishing out 800-ish watts reliably to your components, as much of the energy is usually lost to heat. So its rating is equally as important as its overall wattage. And on top of which, having a higher or overkill wattage, aside from slightly higher electricity bills, may not be beneficial for your rig unless you intend to significantly upgrade in the future, i.e. with an SLI or Crossfire configuration. As more often than not, graphics cards tend to take a lot less wattage real estate than you might think, even at load. For example, my 650 plus gold PSU is more than enough for my GTX 970 card, and will probably be fine with a similar 550 watt power supply. So the point is, you probably need less wattage and instead a better rating than you think. 6. Okay, my next tip may not be applicable to a lot of peeps due to your budget. But if, say, you're not thinking of building a computer for, say, 6 to 9 months, building a very cheap practice rig as a media center or present for someone would be very advantageous, as it eliminates most of the stress of not knowing what you're doing, and gives experience without having to worry about damaging expensive parts like I was. And just doing a build once instills a lot of confidence, as I feel much more confident if I was to build or modify a computer in the future. Now, obviously, you're going to want to keep component costs down to a minimum, but I'd say to refrain from buying really old parts, as not everything you do with an ancient rig may be 100% transferable to the rig you want to build now. Plus, if you're buying secondhand, make sure you buy from a reputable source, as you don't want to have to worry about faulty components and troubleshooting on your first build. That said, anything in the last 5 to 7-ish years would be transferable knowledge. And if you get some components for dirt cheap, parts being faulty isn't really a big deal. I know this isn't an option for everyone, but it's definitely something I wish I'd have done. As although unlikely, one false move and I could have easily damaged a £250 part, and with no experience it makes for a very stressful build. 5. Tailoring your build to be as similar as possible to an online build guide or video is a great idea, as it will mean less time searching the net for info on your specific components and having your head buried in manuals. Although you should still read your manuals, particularly your motherboard manual. The reason for this tip is, you will not only know what to do and in what order to do it, but any little hiccups or advice needed about a specific component or installation will most likely be covered. You could still swap out like-for-like things like similar sized graphics cards and RAM sticks, but in the terms of CPUs, power supplies and wiring up your mobile or motherboard, seeing the installation firsthand could be very helpful and save a lot of time. Just make sure your build guide is very meticulous and by someone or a website you trust, as if it's sketchy and full of misinformation, it could do more harm than good. 4. Buy an anti-static wristband. Sure, there's lots of conflicting information on whether or not they're necessary, but the way I see it, for a couple of bucks and a mild annoyance, is it really worth the worry of damaging hundreds of pounds or dollars worth of equipment, especially if you get a lot of static in your house and are building in a room with carpet? As for essentially the price of a hamburger, and in my opinion just for the peace of mind, it is well worth the price. And later down the road when you become more adept, you can always decide not to use it or try latex gloves or something. Also, if it gets in your way during the build, you can always put it around your ankle. 3. Don't be a numpty like me and try and build your PC on a mat on the ground. Sure, it's possible, but the amount of shapes you have to hold to fit and check certain components is like doing yoga. A dedicated table area is a much better choice, as the elevation and orientation of your PC makes for a much easier and less backbreaking build. Definitely a mistake I won't be repeating again. 2. Do not panic. It's so easy to freak out when you don't know what you're doing and have no experience. But if you've done your due diligence, enough research, and or are following a build guide, you're probably gonna be fine. I freaked out a bunch of times and it was all for nothing. My computer posted first time and thus far, touch wood, hasn't had any major problems. There was a RAM stick not seated properly, but once I noticed the problem, it only took a couple of minutes to fix. So I was freaking out over nothing, and when you're panicking, you don't make smart decisions. So take a breath, chill out and trust in your research. Don't get me wrong, there are legitimate times that feel like cause for concern. For example, installing the CPU is terrifying. When closing the latch to secure the CPU, it sounds like a trash compactor. I don't know if this is just an Intel thing or not, but from what I've heard, installing Intel is supposed to be easier. Easier maybe, but definitely unnerving. And installing my aftermarket cooler was a pain in the ass. but in the end it all turned out fine, and if I can do it, you sure as shit can. 1. And last but by no means least, don't forget about your tools and accessories. Once you've ordered all your parts and even deep into your build, you can easily forget about the little things that are either essential or just plain useful and make life easier. Things that you may have overlooked, like cable ties and Velcro strips for cable management, an extra long posi driver or crosshead screwdriver to reach those hard to reach screws, preferably a magnetic tip one in case you drop a screw or don't have space to hold it with the other hand. And don't worry about the magnet, it shouldn't be strong enough to damage any components. I accidentally touched all sorts of things on the motherboard and it didn't create any issues. Next, a torch, or flashlight if you're an American, is super helpful to read things on your mobo and see what you're doing when your board is already installed. Needle nose pliers can also be helpful when installing your hard drive LEDs and so on, as well as cutting your cable ties if said pliers have that function. And of course for our overclockers, don't forget to get an aftermarket cooler and thermal paste or your computer will be sitting idle for a day or two waiting for parts. So, that's all she wrote. There are my 10 tips I've accumulated from my experiences that I hope will help you to build your first PC. Again, I'm no expert, but hopefully that will make it easier for you to relate to what I'm saying. I've done my research, so hopefully there's no misinformation in this video from my end. And yeah, I hope this helps. So, this just leaves me to say if you enjoyed my video, please like, comment, share and subscribe for more BS of a similar nature. Thank you and goodbye. We'll be right back.